In May 1963, 32 independent African states, with genuine hopes and visions of the continent of Africa, came together in Addis Ababa, the capital of Ethiopia, to create the Organization of African Unity, OAU. The OAU is the predecessor of the current African Union, also known as the AU. It started its operations on the 13th of September 1963, when its charter was adopted, committed to bring about change and freedom to many African countries, and restore the dignity of African people. But the origins of the OAU were difficult. In fact, the idea almost collapsed before it could get off the ground, because of ideological differences that were deeply rooted in the continent's colonial past. The formation of the OAU was rooted in the idea of Pan-Africanism, which originated in the US in the late 19th century. Thousands of blacks with African origins found it intolerable to bear the agonizing experience of racial discrimination and alienation. Some of the prominent leaders were Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois and Marcus Garvey, who raised the flag of revolt against the prevailing injustice. Building on this, Marcus Garvey, a black nationalist, urged the return of Africans to the continent, which he attempted to facilitate through the establishment of a shipping company, the Black Star Line, aimed at transporting black Africans back to Africa. On the continent itself, several prominent intellectuals and heads of state, such as Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Julius Nyerere of Tanzania, Ahmed Sekou-Toure of Guinea, and Kenneth Kaunda of Zambia, took up the cause of advancing the Pan-African ideal. A series of Pan-African congresses were convened to further the interests of African peoples and discuss methods to achieve a unification. When Ghana became independent in 1958, Kwame Nkrumah linked Ghana's independence to that of Africa, recognizing that the independence of Ghana is meaningless unless it is linked up with the total liberation of the continent. Nkrumah therefore established a series of conferences hosted in Accra between 1958 and 1960, with the aims of assisting countries still under colonial rule. During the conferences, Nkrumah presented a vision of the United States of Africa. To his disappointment, the majority of those in attendance were overwhelmingly against the idea. The disagreements led to the emergence of three ideological blocs on the African continent, which included the Casablanca Group, Monrovia Group, and the Brazzaville Group. It is these three groups and their differences that would give birth to the OAU. Meeting in Casablanca, the capital of Morocco, in early 1961, Kwame Nkrumah, Sekou-Toure, Gamal Abdel Nasser, and Modibo Keita resolved to strongly oppose colonialism, racism, neocolonialism, and formation of an African military high command. Other members of the group included Libya, Morocco, and Algeria. During the height of the Katanga secessionist movement in the Congo, the Casablanca powers resolved to extend support to Patrice Lumumba's efforts to oust the Belgians from the Congo, demanded French withdrawal from Algeria, and condemned the apartheid system in southern Africa. Apart from being critical of the French nuclear testing in the Sahara, the group was also worried about neocolonial ties between France and its former colonies. So, Ghana and Guinea provided support to anti-West parties, which included to topple pro-French regimes in Francophone Africa, by mobilizing support for radical forces from within and outside Africa. The members of the Casablanca group aimed at building a United States of Africa, of which Nkrumah would be the head, with a common monetary, foreign, and defense policy. In contrast to the Casablanca group was the Monrovia group, named after the capital of Liberia, where they held their first ever meeting in May 1961. The Monrovia group allied with the Brazzaville group, which included Francophone states like Ivory Coast, Gabon, Niger, Senegal, Upper Volta, and Mauritania. In addition, it had members like Nigeria, Somalia, and Liberia. The group stood for protecting national sovereignty, territorial integrity, and the independence of its members. They were strictly opposed to the idea of a United States of Africa. They strongly defended the principle of mutual non-interference in interstate relations, although they welcomed interstate technical and economic cooperation. Instead of snapping ties with the West, the Monrovia bloc sought Western cooperation in the process of promoting development. Several African leaders, including Tanzania's Julius Nyerere and Nigeria's Abubakar Tafawa Balewa, were supportive of the idea of African unity. But many felt that Nkrumah's grand vision for the United States of Africa was overreaching and risked dissolving the sovereignty and territorial integrity, a point of particular contention among countries who had recently gained independence and fought hard for their sovereignty. By the early 1960s, most of the independent African states had pledged allegiance to either the Monrovia or the Casablanca group. And at this stage, majority had sided with the Monrovia bloc, with 20 supporters out of the 27 independent African states at the time. To attract more members on either sides, both groups reached out to Ethiopia in January 1962. They sent out invitations to Ethiopia to attend their conferences. The Casablanca group had a conference in Cairo, while the Monrovia group had a conference in Lagos. Emperor Haile Selassie, the Ethiopian leader, used the invitations as an opportunity to mediate between the two factions. So, he attended the Monrovia group conference in January 1962 in Lagos, Nigeria. While there, he lobbied to host the next conference in 1963 and promised to have the Casablanca powers in attendance. The emperor received no resistance since Ethiopia was seen as an acceptable venue by both groups who were desperate to get a solution to their disagreements. With the Monrovia group on board, the Ethiopians, through its foreign minister, Ketema Yifru, reached out to the president of Guinea, Sekou Toure. During the Casablanca group conference in June 1962, Haile Selassie invited Toure for a state visit to Ethiopia, which he duly accepted. At the visit, the emperor pointed out that the conflicting views of the Monrovia and Casablanca groups could create a permanent division on the continent, and advised the Guinean delegation that it was in the best interest of both governments to stop such a drastic occurrence from taking place. In the end, the two heads of state issued a communique that stated that both governments believed the gap between the two blocs was soaring. Therefore, to protect the continent from falling into harm's way, the governments of Ethiopia and Guinea had called an all-African summit conference in Addis Ababa, hoping to resolve the differences that had existed between the Casablanca and Monrovia blocs. By May 1963, 32 independent African states had accepted the invitation to attend the All-Independent African Conference in Addis Ababa that included, above all, drafting a new charter. Reconciling the two rival groups was simple because both groups were moving in the same direction and had a lot in common. Eventually, they concentrated on cooperating on the issues of common concern coupled with mediatory effects of Ethiopia. During the conference, the charter of the OAU was adopted as an outcome of a compromise between the two contradictory approaches. On the one hand, the charter pledged to oppose colonialism, racism, and neocolonialism, which satisfied the Casablanca powers. And on the other hand, it comforted the Monrovia group by upholding the principle of non-interference and defense of territorial sovereignty in interstate affairs. After some deliberations, 32 heads of state signed the OAU Charter in Addis Ababa on the 25th of May 1963, marking the birth of the OAU. One of OAU's greatest achievements was the help it provided to liberation movements like the ANC and ZANU in Southern Africa to dismantle the white minority rule. African states under the OAU provided training grounds and sanctuary to these guerrillas until the South African states achieved their independence. A further achievement of the OAU was its encouragement of developmental regional economic communities such as the ECOWAS, SADC, among others. It was also successful over the years in trying to mediate in conflicts between states. For example, it helped mediate a border dispute between Algeria and Morocco and between Somalia, Ethiopia, and Kenya. Apart from bringing about reconciliation between two groups, the OAU had to own up Africa's colonial past. To perpetuate interstate harmony, the founding fathers of the OAU Charter legitimized the interstate boundaries drawn by colonial powers, primarily during the Berlin Conference of 1885. By accepting the status quo on the issue of state frontiers, the OAU Charter left the gate for likely outburst of ethnic and secessionist movements wide open, sowing one of the most important seeds of interstate conflicts. Against the backdrop of the Cold War, the OAU faced considerable challenges to the execution of its objectives. Since its inception, the organization was widely mocked as a bureaucratic talking shop with little power, whose summits had no tangible achievements other than lavish spending. The founders squandered state resources when governments competed for the privilege of holding the annual conference of the Organization of African Unity, at the time when their countries faced economic hardships. Nkrumah set the precedent in 1965 by building a palace containing 60 luxury suites, a banqueting hall capable of seating 2,000 guests at a cost of £10 million. Nkrumah dreamed that it would serve as a future capital for the United States of Africa. However, the conference turned into an abject failure because of Nkrumah's foreign policy, which had alienated so many governments. A group of 14 leaders led by Félix Houphouët-Boigny agreed to boycott in retaliation for Nkrumah's support of subversive activities against their governments. In the end, 28 out of the 36 members of the OAU attended the meeting, but only 13 were represented by the heads of state. President Omar Bongo of Gabon ordered the construction of several seafront hotels in Libreville for an OAU summit and a special new palace for himself with sliding doors and walls, rotating rooms and a private nightclub, all costing over $200 million. President Sheikh Stevens spent 2/3 of Sierra Leone's national budget to host an OAU summit meeting. Togo spent $120 million, half of the national budget, on building a 30-story hotel and a conference center in Lomé, which included 52 presidential suites, hoping to persuade the OAU to transfer its permanent headquarters from Addis Ababa to Lomé. But the OAU did not agree to the move. The founders of the OAU deliberately created a weak organization. The charter forbade member states from interfering in the affairs of other member states and declared sovereign equality of all members. The very thinking of its members, coupled with powers given to it, made the OAU virtually powerless to deal with coups, counter-coups, even if they resulted in the overthrow of governments that were staunchly committed to its goals. When one of the founding members, Emperor Haile Selassie, was overthrown, murdered, and buried under a toilet, the man responsible for his overthrow, Colonel Mengistu Haile Mariam, subsequently welcomed the delegates back to the OAU headquarters in Addis Ababa. The delegates thanked him for his warm and generous hospitality. A quite similar trend also happened in Ghana, where Nkrumah was overthrown and exiled. The military junta sent a delegation that was warmly given a seat to represent Ghana on the principle of non-interference. Further government overthrows occurred in Mali, Nigeria, Sierra Leone, Libya, Gambia, Chad, Guinea-Bissau, and the Central African Republic, as well as the Democratic Republic of Congo, in a series of coups and counter-coups which established military dictatorships and set African states on a path to perpetual civil war. All that the OAU could do was to just watch and look on. The OAU established no proactive conflict prevention and resolution mechanisms rather than receiving aid from Europe and the United States as well as the UN. It struggled to enforce its decisions, and its lack of an armed force made intervention exceedingly difficult. Civil wars in Nigeria, Rwanda, Sudan, and Angola continued unabated for years. The OAU could do nothing but look on as millions and millions died. By the late 1990s, people in Africa had lost faith in governments, and so governments lost interest in people. In its 39 years of existence, the OAU did little to protect the rights and liberties of African citizens from their own political leaders, often dubbing it as a dictator's club. If anything, it gave protection, legitimacy, and free will to dictators to do as they want without fear of accountability or repercussions. By the late 1990s, the OAU had clearly become ineffective on the continent. So, leaders like Muammar Gaddafi stepped up. In 1999, he invited African leaders to a special summit in Sate, where he revealed his plan for a United States of Africa, complete with a continental presidency, a single military force, and a common African currency, all to be approved there and then. The outcome was that in 2001, the OAU was replaced by the African Union, an organization adorned with a plethora of institutions that included the Pan-African Parliament, the Pan-African Court of Justice, and the Pan-African Central Bank, as well as the Peace and Security Council. It was also granted greater powers. Whereas the OAU was required by charter to refrain from interference in individual states, the African Union was given the right to intervene without consent in any member state in order to restore peace and stability or to prevent war crimes, genocides, and crime against humanity in response to a serious threat to legitimize order. The rebranding of the OAU to AU has achieved little success, and the problems that the OAU faced continue to haunt and hinder the success of the AU to this day.